Good morning. Thank you for joining us here at Crossroads Baptist Church. I am so excited that we get to celebrate the resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Even though it seems like everything around us is changing, even though it seems like everything around us is in turmoil and disarray, we serve a God who is still alive. We serve a Savior today. We celebrate the Lord Jesus Christ today, who is still alive. Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, and forever. And I want to say thank you today for joining us this morning. Wherever you may be, from wherever you may be watching, I want to welcome you to this service this morning. Whether you're on directly from our website, cbcmass.com, whether you came on Facebook or YouTube, I want you to take a moment, if this is your very first time, or you've never let us know who you are, or how we can better pray for you, or how we can connect with you, take a moment. Each of those interactive platforms, there's a link that is shared with you. And if you'll just give us at least your name, an email address, or whatever other information you're comfortable sharing with us, we want to have a record of your viewing this morning. And that's not so we can be creepy or so we can bother you. We just want to send a personal greeting to you, thanking you, and seeing if there's any way we as a church, me as a pastor, and we can be a minister to you. And maybe there's something we can pray about. And we can send you an email, even when we have an opportunity to come back together. If you're viewing locally, we'd love to send you an invite for when we come back together, whenever that may be physically. Our first service back is going to be in our brand new location. So maybe you visited before, but we're going to be in a brand new location at 512 Main Street whenever we are able to come back together. This Sunday was supposed to be our first Sunday in that spot. But today, we're in my house. But the Lord is in control. He knows all of this. And we want to take this opportunity. Maybe if we were meeting over there, some of you would not have ever been coming. But you're watching today from the confines of your own home. And I want to say thank you for joining us. Thank you for checking us out. There's so many options, but you took time this morning to worship with us today. In just a few moments, we're going to sing a few songs. And normally, on these Easter Sundays, especially, we like to sing some of the great hymns of the faith. Songs like He Arose. He arose the victor from the dark domain, and He lives forever the saints to reign. A beautiful song, a great song. Songs like He Lives. Just simply that. Jesus is alive. He lives. Maybe songs like Christ the Lord is risen today. Hallelujah. And I'm so thankful that we have these great hymns. But this morning, we're going to sing a few songs that were provided for us that you can sing along with. Maybe church family, when we get back together, we'll sing a group of Easter songs together when Michelle can play the piano and we can just sing from our hymnal or from the screens and the words will be there. So we'll still sing those songs. I'm not trying to get rid of those. But today, because we're having to do all this online like this, we have a few songs that I hope you would sing together with us. And we're excited. There's still songs that sing about the Lord. There's still songs that sing of His resurrection and what Jesus has done for us. But before we do that, I want to have a word of prayer together. So wherever you may be right now, just pause. Let's bow our heads and let's ask the Lord's blessing upon our time together today. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, I thank You today for Your love. Lord Jesus, we praise You today for who You are and for the work that You've done. We serve a risen Savior today, and we celebrate You. We worship You. We praise You. Lord, we thank You for this resurrection day. Lord, as we sing together, as we sing from our homes with our families, as we look at Your word this morning, I pray that You would be honored. I pray that You would be glorified. And I pray that whoever's watching and listening this morning would be helped, encouraged. Lord, if there's someone that does not know You as their personal Savior, I pray before this service is over, they would place their faith and trust in Thee and Thee alone. Bless our time together, we pray. Be honored in our singing. Be glorified in our midst, we ask. Meet with us wherever we may be today. We pray and ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still, when striving cease. My comforter, my all and all, here in the love of Christ I stand. Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe. This gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on the cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid. Here in the death of Christ I live. Body lay, light of the world by darkness slain. Then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands at victory, since Christ has lost its grip on me, for I am his. Bought with the precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my death. Till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ I'll stand.
Thank you.
I hope you enjoyed singing with us this morning, and I'm so glad that we can have songs of the faith that celebrate our risen Savior. In just a few minutes, we're going to sing one more song. Actually, Michelle and the girls have wanted to sing a song that is a brand new Easter song that they've been singing for a couple weeks, and they wanted to share it with you. And there'll still be words on there if you can get the melody and you want to sing along with them. But in just a moment, after they sing, I'm going to bring a message from the Word of God, a message of victory, and how we can have victory through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And I hope you have your Bible, or you've taken time to look it up on your device and follow along for the message from God's Word in just a moment. But before that, Michelle and the girls want to sing, and I'll be right back with a message. Well, I hope you enjoyed that last song, Christ Our Hope in Life and Death. And truth is, He is our hope. And it doesn't matter whether we're here in life or in death, Christ is our hope because He's alive and because of that empty tomb. And He has given us the victory. And today we're going to start a series on this Resurrection Sunday of victory. We're going to look at, in the coming weeks, and at areas in our life that we can gain victory and how Jesus has helped us get the victory. But today we're going to look at Christ as our ultimate example and our ultimate victor. Jesus Christ has given us the victory. I'm thankful for the empty tomb. I'm thankful that this Easter we can celebrate and the resurrected Savior. I don't know about you, but Easter is a holiday that's celebrated by many. Actually, if you're here listening this morning, you're probably celebrating in some way, shape, or form as well. But Easter is a holiday that's celebrated by many all over the world. It's celebrated by many with different reasons. Some celebrate Easter thinking of bunnies and rabbits and Easter eggs and Easter baskets and egg hunts and things of that nature and candy and spring and festivals like that. There's nothing wrong with a lot of those things in their place. Those are fun. And, you know, we have four girls and we like to hide eggs and let them find candy and things of that nature. And they enjoy that. And there's nothing wrong with that. But to many, that's all Easter is just a holiday. But for believers this morning, for our church this morning, Easter is more than just a holiday. It is a high holy day. It is the day that we set aside to celebrate the resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And it's because of the empty tomb, because of the resurrection, we have hope today. And it's because of the resurrection that we even meet on this first day of the week. And I don't know about you, but I hope Easter has a special place in your life. And I hope you have a personal relationship with the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Today we'll look at a passage of scripture that deals entirely with his resurrection. But no, it's not in Matthew. No, it's not in Mark, Luke, or John. Any of what we would consider the gospel records. And it may seem a little bit of an interesting place to go. But we're going to look at 1 Corinthians chapter 15. We're going to start the end of the chapter, and then we're going to jump back to the very beginning of the chapter and really just give a basic message this morning from God's Word that I think will be a help, an encouragement, and a challenge to us. We're going to look at the fact that Jesus Christ has given us the victory. In the weeks ahead, we'll look at different areas in our life that we can be victorious and that Jesus has given us the victory and as he has exampled how to be victorious. And I hope you join us, not just today, but continuing. So for the next few minutes this morning, I hope you have your Bible. If you don't have a physical copy of God's Word, I hope you pull out your tablet or wherever you may find it and on your phone and pull up 1 Corinthians chapter number 15. And Easter is a special time that we ought to take time to reflect upon. We ought to take time this Easter and every Easter to think about the events and activities of the resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. For the Christian, Easter represents our deliverance from sin and bondage. It is a time that we are reminded of all that the Lord has done for us and all that we have in him. The empty tomb is the ultimate example of a victorious Savior. I don't know about you, but I like to be on the winning side. I like to be victorious in my life. I like to be victorious in my activities. As a kid, I played sports, and my wife and I, even at home, and our girls were very competitive, and we like to be the victor. We like to win. In life, we all want to win. In life, nobody likes to be a loser. In life, nobody likes to lose. But in the big picture of life, are you on the winning side? Are you on the side of our Lord Jesus Christ? Are you on the side of the empty tomb? Jesus has already gained the victory. In these days, we're living in perilous times. We don't know what today holds. We don't know what tomorrow holds in the midst of all this virus and all this pandemic going on. But we do know that many of us have questions. What's going to happen? What does all this mean? Am I going to die? Those are real life questions. Those are real life issues. Those are things that each and every one of us are dealing with. Those are things that we have to make sure we have settled. We have to have these things settled. And today, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, one of the longest chapters in the New Testament. I want to draw your attention to verse number 50, 5. The Bible says, O grave, where is thy sting? O death, excuse me, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. But thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. You want to be on the victorious side? I can imagine that Satan had thought he had won. That verses start with, O grave, O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? Satan has been in a constant battle for your soul and for mine. He's in a constant battle against God. He's in a constant battle to gain a victory. But you know what? Ultimately, he is lost. As much as the dark days following the crucifixion of our Savior, the devil thought he won. There's been many times all throughout history and throughout the Bible and all throughout the Old Testament we can see the devil thinking he'd won. The devil thinking he would destroy the very opportunity for a Savior to be born. But yet, constantly, like an ongoing battle, and round after round after round after round, God continuously was getting the victory. And Jesus gained the ultimate victory. Death no longer has a sting. Nobody looks forward to dying. Jesus, in the very last hours of his life, prayed, God, if there's any other way, let this cup pass from me. He was not looking forward to dying. Nobody does. But as a believer, as a Christian, we don't have to look towards the sting of death because Jesus has already conquered death. That's why today we can celebrate an empty tomb. We can celebrate life. We have hope because Jesus has been risen from the dead and he's alive forevermore. In order for us to understand that, and that truth we celebrate this Easter, let's take a few minutes this morning and deal with some truths around the resurrection of Jesus. Some truths regarding the gospel. Jesus has won the victory. So what does that mean for you and for me? What does that mean? How does that affect our lives? How does that affect me as a believer? How does that affect you as maybe a believer, or as maybe somebody just tuning in this morning for the first time and you don't know anything about it? Maybe you're searching. Maybe somebody watching today is hurting. There's people hurting all around us. Are you hurting this morning? Are you troubled? Are you unsure of what tomorrow holds? Today, this Easter Sunday, this Easter morning, you can have hope. You can have peace. You can have victory in your life. Why? Because Jesus has already made a way. Jesus has already won the victory. O grave, where is thy victory? O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? Why? But thanks be to God, who giveth us the victory through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. This morning, let's take a few minutes at this portion of Scripture, in this chapter 15 of 1 Corinthians. We start at the end. Let's jump way back to the beginning. We're going to look at the gospel and what the gospel means to you and what the gospel means to us and how Easter is truly the gospel, the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. This passage may not be a typical Easter passage. We're not dealing with one of the gospel records, but it reveals the substance of what we celebrate. Paul has shared the truths of the gospel with those in Corinth, and Easter itself is the gospel. We cannot truly celebrate Easter apart from the gospel, the good news. We're living right now with lots of bad news. Maybe you've lost your job. Maybe you know somebody who's come down with this pandemic. Maybe you just don't know where to turn. You turn the news on and it seems like everything's going to get worse. There's bad news all around us. I simply want to today declare unto you some good news. Jesus is alive and he's won the victory. And you know what? You and me, we can participate in that victory today. And we can celebrate together the victory. Why? Because we're going to declare unto you today the gospel, the good news. So you say this morning, I'm a believer. Should I just tune out? No. The gospel's not just for the lost. The gospel's for the saved. The message of hope and redemption through Jesus Christ is not our end place. It is our being, in that our faith in Jesus Christ not only gets us saved, but sustains us and keeps us and motivates us to continue. So this morning, we're going to declare unto you the gospel, the victory that Christ has won. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse number 1. I'm in 13, don't need to be there. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 1 says, "Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel, which I preached unto you, which also ye have received, and wherein ye stand, by which also ye are saved, if ye keep in memory that I preached unto you, unless ye have believed in vain." Now notice verse 3. "For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures." That, friends, is the gospel. And we're going to look at four truths this morning, and then we'll be done, regarding this victory. Jesus died on the cross for all the world. So what does it mean to you? What does it mean to me? The first truth I see this morning is the truth of the incarnation. Let's look at verse number. What is so insignificant about this resurrection day? What is so significant about this man named Jesus? The first thing I see in verse number 3 is this: "For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins." The truth, number one, is the truth of the incarnation. Here Paul is speaking to this church at Corinth, and he's speaking to them concerning the man Jesus Christ. Incarnation literally means to be robed in flesh. This is not just any man we're dealing with. This is the God-man. This is God himself robed in flesh as a man. Paul wanted them to center their hearts upon Jesus and in him alone. He's declaring unto them that Christ died for our sins. There were those in Paul's day, no doubt, who doubted who Jesus was, just as there are those today who doubt who Jesus is. What does Jesus mean to you? Who is Jesus to you today? Is he just a good man? Is he just a prophet who has died? Is it just a historical figure? Is he just a figment? The truth is, if we would say that and believe that Jesus, who he claimed to be, he could not be a good man if he was not God. Because he claimed to be God. And what sort of good man would claim to be God if he was not? Jesus is God. And that's significant. That's significant as we walk through this journey of the Scripture and why he was able to gain the victory. If Jesus was just any ordinary man, he'd be like you and he'd be like me. He would simply be a martyr for a cause. But no, he was God. He was the incarnation the truth of the incarnation. He was the holy, sinless, eternal God-man. "For God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten Son." Paul is emphasizing the fact that Jesus was the Messiah. He was who he claimed to be. In Christ, the true and living God, he took on a robe of flesh and dwelt among men. And truth is, this morning, it's impossible to celebrate Easter without also accepting the incarnation of Christ. We can't go any farther if we don't know who Jesus was to take the place of us. Who this man was who died on the cross, he was and he is God himself, the very Son of God. Many in our day have no problem accepting the fact that Jesus lived upon this earth, but not the fact. We must embrace the fact that he is the only begotten Son of God, the Savior of the world. I wonder on this Easter Sunday morning, how do you view Christ? Do you believe that He lived here upon this earth? Do you believe that He came as God in the flesh? Are you convinced that Jesus is who He claimed to be? Before we go any farther, you must understand that Jesus is God in the flesh. The Bible says in the book of John, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. Jesus is God. That's important. So we see the truth of the incarnation. Number two, we see the truth of the crucifixion. Same passage, verse 3 and 4. For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins. He died for you, and He died for me, and He was buried. Here's the truth. God died. Jesus died. Excuse me. The gospel records the events of the crucifixion for us. The circumstances around Jesus' death are important for us to understand. He was a man who knew no sin. He was a man who knew no sin. He was perfect. Pilate could find no fault in Him. Herod could find no fault in Him. Pilate himself declared, "He's innocent. I find no fault in Him." He wasn't somebody who deserved to die. He wasn't somebody who had any reason to die. The religious leaders and the vast majority of the Jews would have it no other way, though. They would not accept it. They brought false accusers. They brought people to lie about Him. And as we view the cross, we see an innocent man hanging there. Understand, Jesus had no reason to die. He Himself died an awful, vile, painful, excruciating death. His life was lived in communion with God. He was God. He loved all that He met. He was peaceful. He even loved those He didn't meet. He was kind to His tormentors. He loved those that persecuted Him. He loved those that nailed Him to that tree. The innocent man was scourged mercilessly and nailed to a rugged cross. He fed many. He calmed seas. And He died as an innocent man. He was ridiculed. He was mocked. A crown of thorns was placed upon His head, and a spear was thrust into His side. The multitudes that gathered had no mercy upon Him. Yet He showed them love. He showed them mercy. He showed them compassion. The Son of God bled and died upon that cross. And after His death, His lifeless body was laid in a tomb. So what is significant about this death? What is significant about this crucifixion? It's this. There's the truth that He is God. There's the truth that He died. He died a perfect man. But the truth is this. The truth of the substitution. One might ask, why was He put to death? Why was He crucified upon the cross? If He was innocent, why did He have to die? Why? There's nothing wrong with asking why. The answer to that question is found here. Verse 3 again. For I delivered unto you the first of all that which I also received, how that Christ, notice this, died for our sins, according to the Scriptures. He was not there because He was guilty. He was there because I am guilty. He was there because He was not there because He deserved the cross. He was not there because Pilate had told Him to be there. Or He's not there even because the Jews had cried out for His crucifixion. No, He was there for you and for me. He died for our sins. What a Savior. What a Savior. He died for our sins. He died that we might be forgiven. He died that we might be restored. Jesus was our substitute. As we view the cross, we ought to view a Savior who took our place. He bore our sin and He bore our shame. This was the way that God had planned it before the foundation of the world, was this. It was love. He willingly gave His life that we should be saved. What a thought. He was able to gain the victory over death for us because He was our substitute. The truth, the incarnation, crucifixion, substitution, but then you know what? If that was it, the story would be hopeless still. But Jesus is alive today. The truth is, he didn't stay dead. Otherwise, he just would have been a martyr for a cause. No, he's alive. That's how he became victorious for you and for me, because he rose again the third day, and he's now alive today as he was on that first Easter morning. The truth of the resurrection. Notice verse 4. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 4. And that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day, according to the scriptures. Jesus died upon the cross. He was buried in the tomb, but praise God, he didn't stay dead. No, the grave could not hold him. The tomb could not contain him. He rose victorious the third day. What a glorious Savior. What a thought that Jesus died as our substitute. He died in our place. And yet he rose again. He satisfied the righteous demands of the Father, and he conquered sin and death for all mankind. That's why we meet today. Virtually, we can't meet in person, but virtually, why do we meet today? We serve a risen Lord. He is no longer in the tomb. He came forth as he said he would. And as though he can say, he even... How many people can even declare their death and then not even just that, but declare they're going to rise again? Nobody but Jesus. On that first Easter morning, the women were coming to the tomb. That first Easter morning in Luke chapter 24, verse 5 and 6 says, "And as they were afraid," they didn't know what was going to happen, "they bowed down their faces to the earth. They said unto them," the angels, "Why seek ye the living amongst the dead? He is not here, for he is risen but he is risen. Remember how he spake unto you when he was yet in Galilee." What a Savior. This is what sets Jesus apart from all the other gods of this world. You can find the leaders of religious groups, their tombs all around. You can find the tomb of Jesus, but theirs are filled with their bones. Jesus is empty. The tomb is empty. Why? Because he had the victory over death, in the victory over hell, in the victory over the grave. I cannot emphasize the importance of this truth enough. Had Jesus not risen, he'd be no different than anyone else. Had he not conquered death, the grave, he would have no hope. We would have no hope of life after death. But we have hope today of life after death. Believer, you have hope tomorrow. You have hope to make it. Why? Because no matter what you're going to come in contact with, no matter what may come your way, Jesus has already gained the victory. And he's proven it time and time and time again. If you this morning have never trusted Jesus as your personal Savior, the fact of his resurrection and his conquering power over death, hell, and the grave can give you hope, can give you peace, can give you comfort. I declare unto you this morning the gospel, that Jesus is victorious. Well, good. What does it mean to me? Our text this morning in verse 1 says this, "Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel, which I preached unto you, and which also ye have received, and wherein ye stand." Jesus died for the sins of all the world. He had to die for us. Why? Because we are not perfect. Because our sin separates us from a holy, righteous God. As sin entered in the bloodstream of Adam and that first man, sin has carried on throughout all the centuries, throughout all of time. And we are born sinners. But Jesus, who is God, died on the cross to pay that penalty for you and for me. He died as our substitute in our place. We deserve to be hanging there that day, but we would have died and stayed in that tomb. But Jesus, because he is God, dying in our place, paid our penalty, and he rose again. He is victorious, and because he's victorious today, we can have life eternal. We can have a way of having a relationship with our Heavenly Father. The sacrifice that Jesus made upon the cross is the source of our salvation. His sacrifice is the source of our salvation. Jesus died for the sins of all humanity. Your sins and my sins were paid for at Calvary, but that doesn't guarantee your salvation. a head knowledge of the historical fact of what happened that day on Calvary and 3 days later in an empty tomb and that garden, that fact alone does not save us. No, you must admit, as I must admit, that I'm a sinner and I need a Savior and accept that gift that He's given us. We must make a conscious decision to accept the Lord. On this Resurrection Sunday, on this Easter morning, if you've never placed your faith and trust in Jesus, and if you've never believed in your heart the gospel, I want to invite you this morning to trust in Jesus. None of us are good enough. If there was a way that we could be good enough, why would Jesus have to die? If it was up to us and our good deeds, then that means the deeds of Jesus on the cross was not good enough or didn't even need to be done. Why would God sentence His Son to die in our stead if our deeds would be good enough? We'll never be good enough. Well, you got to place, and if you think that you have to believe in Jesus and still do something else, then that means that still what He did was not good enough. If you're trusting in your belief in Jesus and what you're doing, that's going to fail. Your deeds will never be good enough to please a holy God. We must place our faith and trust in the finished work of Jesus. Why? Because, O death, where is thy sting? O grave, why? He has given us the victory through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Wouldn't it be awful to die in our sins when there's been a way for forgiveness? When there's been a way to get out? Jesus has made a way. Jesus has made a way this morning in the fact that He rose again. He died for you, He died for me. Have you personally trusted Him as your Savior? You may have just tuned in this morning with no hope. You may have tuned in this morning trusting in your good deeds. There's plenty of good people, no doubt, watching this morning. Doesn't matter how good we are, there is none good but God. But Jesus was our substitute, and He won the victory that we can have a relationship for eternity with God. Will you this morning place your faith and trust in Him, in Him alone? It's not in some magical words. It's not in a special prayer. But it's in you realizing that you're a sinner. God loved you so much, He died for you on the cross as your substitute. And if you asked Him to forgive your sins and to accept that gift of salvation, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved, knowing that Him and Him alone is our source of salvation and our source of victory. This morning you can. And I plead with you this morning, if you have any questions, reach out. If you have any concerns, reach out. If you have anything today that you need, reach out. If you've trusted Jesus as your Savior this morning, we want to be able to give you something, placing your hands to help you to grow. This morning, Christian, the gospel is not just something for the lost. It's something that motivates us to live for Him each and every day. It gives us hope for tomorrow. It gives us hope for our loved ones. The fact that Jesus has conquered the victory of death, hell, and the grave gives us hope for tomorrow. But today, let's think much of Jesus. That tomb is empty. Because that tomb is empty, we have hope today. We have a victory today. I'm on the winning side. How about you? I pray this message has been a help to you this morning. Let's have a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, I thank You today for Your love and for Your mercy and for Your grace. I thank You, Jesus, for the sacrifice on the cross of Calvary for my sins and the sins of all the world. I pray this morning, if there's someone that hears this message that doesn't know You as their personal Savior, I pray before it is eternally too late, they place their faith and trust in Thee and Thee alone. I pray for the Christian this morning that You'd encourage them, that You would strengthen them, that You would help give us hope to continue because of the victory that You've won. God, meet with us in this time, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you for joining us today. And I encourage you to get on our website, cbcmass.com, or the Facebook page, facebook.com/cbcmass, and follow us for any updates of when we're able to meet back together again. And we have live stream our services on Thursdays and Sundays as well from those links if you follow that. But please, if there's anything we can help you with at all, let us know. Hope you have a great Easter with your family. And know this, Jesus has won the victory, and you can too. God bless you. Have a great day.